This is Iowa's news leader. This is KCCI 8 News Close Up.
Good morning, and thank you for joining us for KCCI 8 News Close Up. With me is Des Moines Register political columnist Kathy Obradovich. And for the next half hour, we're going to be talking with Republican presidential candidate George Pataki. Now, before we start this conversation, KCCI chief political reporter Cynthia Fodor has more on the former New York governor.
It's not easy to be elected a Republican governor in a deep blue state, but George Pataki says it shows he can unite people. He defeated Democrat icon Mario Cuomo to become New York's governor for 3 terms. He led the state through the September 11th terrorist attacks, and under his watch reduced the size of state government 15%. The presidential hopeful grew up on a farm, the grandson of Hungarian immigrants. He completed his degree at Yale in 3 years and went on to receive a Columbia law degree. Pataki met his wife body surfing in a hurricane. They have 4 children. Recently in Des Moines, he took aim at Donald Trump, calling for a grown-up government, not a reality show, challenging Trump to a debate on immigration, saying dividing Americans on the basis of race is unacceptable.
Yes, I agree we have to close the borders. Yes, we have to deal appropriately with those who commit crimes when they're here, and this administration is not. But to demonize an entire community of millions of people is just wrong, and I would hope that everyone would stand up and call for an apology.
The 70-year-old has been called progressive on a number of issues, supports abortion rights, is against GOP attacks on same-sex marriage, and calls Obamacare the worst law passed in his lifetime. He's an environmentalist, now president of a company advising on energy and clean tech issues. Pataki admits he's a long shot, but says he has overcome steep odds before. Cynthia Fodor, KCCI 8 News, Iowa's news leader.
And Governor Pataki, thank you for joining us.
Thank you, Kathy.
Now, there are 17 Republican candidates in the race.
That's all?
That's all.
So far.
You know, maybe not enough. I don't know. And you're really just kind of getting started. You're not quite registering in the polls or just barely registering in the polls. In the last quarter, you only raised $250,000. The Wall Street Journal called your candidacy an afterthought. I mean, it's sort of like body surfing in a hurricane. It sounds like it's almost that crazy.
It's kind of like running against Mario Cuomo as a conservative. Republican in New York State, and that was the reaction when I did that. So I managed to win that, and I'm not running this time for the exercise. I believe we need to change this state, this country dramatically, and I know I have the ability to do that.
What path do you see for yourself to the nomination?
Well, I think if you look at what is happening right now, it's all theater. You show up in a helicopter, you wonder whether or not Hillary is going to be indicted, let alone nominated for the presidency. But I think at the end, people understand that this isn't a reality show. This is about running the United States of America, and they're going to want someone who has governed successfully, who has a vision as to how we can bring our country back, make it more economically prosperous, and protect us from radical Islam, and by the way, who can win the election, and I know I can do all 3.
Now, you were governor of New York State from 1995 to 2006. 9 of the 17 Republican candidates are governors or have been governors. Mm-hmm. Aside from that experience, what sets you apart here?
Well, Stacey, first of all, my background is different from anybody else in this race. I'm the New York guy. But I actually grew up on a small farm in upstate New York, and my family still runs a farm in upstate New York. And it's about what you learn, the values you learn on a farm, hard work, strong families. But most importantly, that words don't do it. You have to actually get the job done. And I think that's one of the things that sets me apart. In a deep blue state, the only Republican conservative ever elected governor in New York State on both lines, I was able to get dramatic change, sweeping conservative change through more than any other state in America. You pointed out in the intro, reducing the size of the workforce by 15%. We were the most dangerous state in America when I took office. When I left, we were the 4th safest. We had the worst record in private sector job growth. When I left, we had the lowest unemployment rate since they started keeping records. The taxes were too high. When I left, we had reduced taxes by $143 billion, more than the other 49 states combined. And I did it with a legislature, a state assembly, that was more than 2-to-1 Democrat. So people talk about changing Washington. A lot of words. But it doesn't seem to ever change. The government gets bigger, the taxes get higher, the distance between the people and the government seems larger. I know I can change that. I did it in New York, I will do it in Washington if I have the chance.
Well, now the tone across the country seems to be Americans are angry on both sides,
yes.
Right and left.
Yes.
You know, you talked about being a Republican in a very blue state. How do you bring the country together? Because right now, all we're hearing is just anger and then politicians, candidates, playing to that anger.
I totally understand that anger. I'm fed up with the federal government as well, which is why I'm running. I left government. I was in the private sector for 8 years and have a tremendous private career. But I share that same just real disappointment is a kind word with the way Washington functions. It is controlled by interest groups, by the rich and the powerful. Our tax code is something that was written by lobbyists for their important client friends. It doesn't serve the people's interest. It serves the politicians' interest. And it doesn't seem to matter which party gets elected. The government keeps growing. And the distance greater. I know I can change that. What you have to do is convert that anger to solutions and to action. And I can do that.
You've been in office, though, one form or another, most of your career, going from being mayor to governor.
Yeah.
And so, people seem to have a real distrust now of the political class.
Yeah.
And so how do you break through that? You talked about theater. Well, Donald Trump, for example, what people say about him is he's not a politician.
That's right.
So,
and there's a lot of value to that. But I think at the end, what you have to do is convert that anger, that distrust of politicians, into action and constructive action to take the country and our government back for the people. And at the end, and when that happens, I don't know, I think the American people are going to say, okay, we need grown-up government. We need mature leadership. We need someone who's going to unite us instead of dividing us for political benefit. You know, it seems the candidates are all out there, whether they're saying, I'm not so sure about vaccinations. I thought that was settled by George Washington at Valley Forge when he vaccinated our troops. Or as Donald Trump was saying, I think hideously, that Mexicans are rapists or thugs. I understand the concern about immigration and the need to control the border, but you don't demonize people. And it's the same on the left with the Democrats. They don't have a positive agenda. They need big government to protect Americans from other Americans. Republicans are going to be at war with the middle class, so you need big government. We're going to be at war with women, with immigrants. It's all nonsense. And I think the American people are fed up with people dividing us for their political benefit instead of uniting us for the people's benefit. And that's what I would do.
Now, you were governor during the 9/11 attacks in New York. How did that experience change your outlook on America's place in the world? And how did it change your outlook on life?
That experience leading New York through September 11th is with me every day. And there is one lesson I learned that day, and I hoped that Americans would never forget, and I certainly won't, and that is that radical Islam, even though it might seem to be a continent, an ocean away, separated by tens of thousands of miles, it poses a threat to us right here in America. And I fear today we are at greater risk than at any time since September 11th.
Is it possible for a president to actually promise that there will never be another attack
no,
on that
what
scale
can,
again?
No, but what I'll tell you I can promise, first of all, is ISIS right now is radicalizing Americans to attack other Americans. We saw what almost happened in Garland, Texas. But for that Texas cop, dozens of American citizens would have been massacred. We saw what happened in Chattanooga, Tennessee with the Marine recruiters. This administration is so weak, their response is to tell the Marines to take off their uniforms. My response would be to tell the Marines to put on their guns and we'd all be safer. We have to stop ISIS from radicalizing Americans, whether they're using the internet, whether they're using mosques or prison imams. You cannot yell fire in a shouted theater. When you tell someone to engage in violence against another American in the name of jihad, that is not freedom of speech. That's not protected speech. That is a crime, and you should be arrested, and I will stop that.
After 9/11, the huge conversation in America was about homeland security,
right.
and how do we make make ourselves safe here at home.
Mm-hmm.
What do you think is the status of homeland security today? And when you talk about the radicalization... How do you prevent attacks?
Kathy, I got to tell you, I am very concerned. First, we have to shut down the ISIS and radical Islam's ability to recruit and radicalize people in America. But look what ISIS has in the Middle East. Al-Qaeda was isolated in Afghanistan. They had no sophisticated weapons. They had no money. They had no Westerners. They had no social media capability. And they carried out that hideous attack. Look at ISIS today. Hundreds of millions of dollars. They control territory. They have thousands of people with Western passports. They have sophisticated weapons and social media. We have got to destroy ISIS over there before they can attack us here. Now, let me say, I learned that lesson, that we have to stand up to radical Islam and defeat it over there before they attack us here. But since then, I've learned another lesson, and that is that we cannot spend a decade, $1 trillion, trying to create a democracy and nation building in a place where a democracy has never existed before. Support the forces on the ground fighting ISIS today. Ramp up
You're
our bombing
about American
attacks.
Forces on
no,
the ground?
I'm talking about the Kurdish Peshmerga, who are not being adequately supplied and trained because this administration sends everything through Baghdad, and Baghdad doesn't want to help the Kurds directly. We should. The Sunni in Anbar province who detest ISIS. We should be aiding them directly. Let them fight the fight. Ramp up our bombing attacks. But I'll tell you, Kathy, if we need to go in to destroy their recruiting centers, their planning hubs, where they're organizing to attack us here, I would send in special ops, destroy those centers, and get out. No 10-year war, no nation building. Destroy them over there before they can attack us here.
And is ISIS more of a threat than Al-Qaeda or just more visible than Al-Qaeda?
I think they both pose a very real threat, particularly Al-Qaeda in the Arabian Peninsula, not so much in Afghanistan, but Al-Qaeda in the Middle East still poses a threat. And the difference has been ISIS has been radicalizing individuals. And I fear, as the FBI director said, there are thousands in the U.S., which is why we have to shut this down and stop it. But Al-Qaeda is looking to have their larger attacks. So we have to attack them over there. No nation building, no 10-year wars. Do everything we can to protect our security here. And by the way, after September 11th, there was a bipartisan commission, and one of their most important sections is, what do we do to prevent this from happening again? And they said, as an example, this was an example they gave, if Iraq becomes a failed state where radical Islam takes hold, we have to use the might of America to destroy them there, or we will have more September 11th attacks. I think that's correct.
And we'll leave it there for a moment. We're going to take a break. When we come back, we'll talk about the line between privacy and security. Welcome back to KCCI 8 News Close Up. With us this morning is Republican presidential candidate George Pataki. Now, we left off talking about security and fighting ISIS here at home. And that, of course, brings us to the question, where do you draw the line between security and privacy when it comes to surveillance and the government storage of Americans' phone records?
You know, when I first saw the revelation that NSA was taking everybody's phone records and keeping them, I was appalled because I don't trust big government to use that data simply in a pure way. But as we learn more, we learn that all they did was being able to collect the numbers. And so if they did find someone who they had reason to believe was engaged or could be engaged in terrorist activity, they would have to go to a court and get permission to get that person's information. And they could not access what was actually in those communications. But they could tell, for example, someone they believe is possibly engaged in planning terrorist attacks in New York was talking with someone in Detroit, and they would have an idea as to whether or not there was a network actually doing this. So I come down on the fact that we don't want to just willy-nilly trust the government. Put in safeguards, but don't deny our security experts information that may be critical to protect us from an attack. And let me, I don't want to seem like a warmonger here when I was talking about the need to destroy ISIS. I have two sons. Both of them after college went into the military. One after college became a Marine officer and served in Iraq. The other after college went into the 10th Mountain Division and just got back from Afghanistan in September. I know what it's like for a parent to lie awake at night, worried about a phone call. I understand that we do not want to put one American life at risk where their loved ones are worrying about their security. But we simply cannot be passive and wait for another attack. We have got to destroy those centers there before they have the chance to attack us again here.
You mentioned safeguards, but I mean, isn't going to a judge and getting a warrant the safeguard that's built into our system?
Essentially that they cannot access that information without going to a court and getting permission from that court. And they have to show proof to the court that, yes, there is adequate suspicion of potential terrorist activity to justify that court saying, yes, you can open it. So it's very similar to getting a warrant.
Okay. And since leaving the governor's office in 2006, you've been working on environmental issues, including climate change. Mm-hmm. While a lot of your Republican colleagues have basically been busy denying that climate change is happening or that people have anything to do with it. So what has persuaded you that human beings can head off climate change? And what would you do as president?
Well, Kathy, first of all, the Senate voted yes, climate change is a change is occurring with human activity, and I think the vote was 98-1. So there is a general acknowledgement that, and I think there has to be, that we are emitting CO2 into the atmosphere. It's a greenhouse gas, all things being equal. The world is going to get warmer. The problem is not that. The problem is the solution. And when I was governor, I did a lot of good conservation environmental things. We preserved over 1 million acres of open space. But I had the belief, the paradigm, that it wasn't a choice between economic growth and opportunity and strong conservation environmental programs. Instead of being at loggerheads, they could be synergistic. And I fear what is happening in Washington is climate change is being used as an excuse to expand government power, to raise government revenue, to raise the costs on the American people, particularly for energy. And as part of an anti-fossil fuel political ideological movement, as opposed to a science-based effort to reduce our CO2 emissions.
So what is the better solution?
It's innovation and technology. Let me just give you one example. Fracking. Natural gas replacing coal. We have lower CO2 emissions in America today than at any time since 1995. And we did it without the government telling people what to do, and we did it by lowering costs to the American people through innovation. The next generation of solar or wind, and by the way, next generation nuclear, there are thallium nuclear reactors that emit zero carbon, no greenhouse gas emissions. They have no residual or nuclear waste. There is no risk of meltdown or proliferation. They don't exist in commercial scale yet, but it's innovation. It's technology. It's inspiring the American innovator and academia and our business organizations to come up with solutions that allow us to grow the economy, create jobs, and yet have a cleaner atmosphere. We're going to do this. I have no doubt.
Take the government out of it, or does the government have a role in making these incentives happen?
Absolutely.
And are there regulations that need to be put in place then to make sure that the bad operators are not taking advantage?
You need regulatory powers. For example, when the fracking boom started, and all of a sudden you had all these wildcats out there, the regulatory framework to monitor, to control, and to make sure things were being done appropriately were not in place. And you have to put those in place first. I was talking about thallium reactors. Our Department of Energy and our NRDC don't do this type of incentivizing of innovative technology. We should have an R&D tax credit, for example, that is permanent. And we should have programs in the government working with industry, working with academia, where we develop these technologies that will allow us to have a cleaner atmosphere, have more confidence in a greener future while growing jobs. You know, one of the reasons I got into government is I think it's government's obligation. I think it's every generation's obligation to leave the world a better place for the next generation than we inherited it. And that's what I tried to do in New York. Yes, it's a stronger economy. Yes, it's national security. Yes, it's more jobs. But it's also having greater confidence in the health, the environment, the atmosphere of America. And I'm confident we can do that.
Well, we are going to take one more break. We are continuing our conversation with Governor Pataki. We'll be right back. Welcome back to KCCI 8 News Close Up. We continue our conversation this morning with Republican presidential candidate George Pataki. Now, you support abortion rights. Does that make you pro-choice?
You know, I think the pro-choice people would tell you no. They don't consider me that because I do believe that there comes a point where not as a matter of my religious faith, but as a matter of science, that the unborn child is a child and worthy of protection. And right now, that I think is around 20 weeks. So I would support legislation outlawing abortions after 20 weeks. And I would ban funding for Planned Parenthood. I think, like everyone who saw those videos, they were just horrible and showed a abhorrent disrespect for basic human dignity. And I don't think Planned Parenthood should be funded. So the pro-choice groups would say, well, clearly he's pro-life. On the other hand, I don't think I have the right to impose my religious views before science says that is a life.
Now, do the pro-life side think that you are a pro-choice candidate then?
Yeah, I mean, I can't worry about, you believe what you believe. Mm-hmm. And I try to be honest with the American people. And I can't tell you the number of politicians who one time are on this side and one time on the other side. And the advisors all tell you, you got to pick one side or the other. And I think that's part of the problem with government. Very often, the solution lies somewhere in the middle, like in this case, banning abortion after 20 weeks and defunding it permanently. But the politicians will tell you, you got to be all on one side or the other. One of the reasons I was able to govern New York successfully was by bringing people together with conservative solutions that worked. And that's what I hope to have the opportunity to do in Washington.
The state of science says 20 weeks, but that science has been changing.
Yes, it does.
And it continues to change.
Yes, it will.
And what the argument is, I think, from people who are pro-life is, you know, that every time the science has changed, it has moved closer to the moment of conception,
right,
which is
That's
where
right.
they feel life begins.
And where I believe, as a matter of faith, life begins.
But if you believe that as a matter of faith, then how can you condone abortions
well, first,
up to 20
first of
weeks?
All, the decision has been the same for 42 years. And Republicans, it's part of what I was getting back to earlier, where people say, I'm going to do this, I'm going to do that, I'm going to do the other thing, and nothing changes. The Supreme Court has issued the ruling 42 years ago. And since that time, it hasn't changed regardless of the politics of the person elected. What can change is banning it at 20 weeks, where science says it's the case today, permanently defunding taxpayer funds for abortion, and defunding Planned Parenthood. Those are things that actually can be done.
Thank you, Governor. We will be right back, and our conversation with Governor Pataki will continue in just a few moments. Well, we are wrapping up our on-air portion with Governor Pataki right now, but our conversation continues on KCCI.com. Head there right now, and thank you for joining us this morning. We'll see you online.